Greetings to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who calls us into his house and makes us clean. We begin our worship this day in singing our opening hymn number 429.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our introit is from Psalm 69. For zeal for your house has consumed me, and the reproaches of those who reproach you have fallen on me. Deliver me from sinking in the mire. Let me be delivered from my enemies and from the deep waters. Let not the flood sweep over me, or the deep swallow me up, or the pit close its mouth over me. Answer me, O Lord, for your steadfast love is good. According to your abundant mercy, turn to me. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. For zeal for your house has consumed me, and the reproaches of those who reproach you have fallen on me. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday of Lent is taken from the book of Exodus, the 20th chapter. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath day to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and mother, that your days may be long in the land that your Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. O come, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Our epistle reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and folly to the Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, whom God made our wisdom and our righteousness and our sanctification and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the second chapter. Glory be to thee, O Lord. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and the money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords,
he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, "Take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." So the Jews said to him, "What sign do you show us for doing these things?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them, because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in a man. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ.
We make confession of our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text for today is taken from our Gospel reading from John chapter 2 with an emphasis on these words. Jesus said, "Take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of trade." This is our text, dear brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. Friends, when you come to this place each week, whether online, in person, or in your vehicles, what is it that you hope to get from your God? Each of us who comes into his house to worship also carries with us a burden, a concern, a trouble, a doubt which needs address. Maybe some are small and some so small that you're not thinking of it, while others can be so big and overwhelming that you're barely able to focus on the words of the sermon today. But you see, whether your problems be big or small, the Lord knows that when he calls us to himself, that we also come with a lot of baggage. We come with our politics, our pettiness, our addictions, our own false interpretations of Scripture, and our misconceptions about what it is that he offers us here in his word and sacraments. We often take his name in vain. We do not do as he commands. We do not love our neighbors as ourselves, and wouldn't you know it, we have a tendency not to check those behaviors at the door when we come into his house. We take all manners of worldliness stemming from our sinful and fallen behavior, and at our very best, we may try to mask them with a smiling face each Sunday morning, or at worst, we might allow them to pervade our Sabbath rest and to undermine the gospel proclamation. We are, all of us, kind of like crummy house guests, and I'm guessing you know the kind if you've ever had them. We're like guests invited to a house party, if you can remember what house parties are like from those pre-COVID days, who take the invitation to make themselves at home just a little bit too literally. They put their feet on the couch. They complain about the temperature. They criticize your choice of music, and they offer their not-so-helpful pointers to jazz up your interior decorating. Or maybe worse, they might over-imbibe, becoming belligerent or outright hostile to their host, attacking them personally, and spurning their hospitality. This, I tell you, has been our posture regarding the third commandment. We have not remembered the Sabbath day, nor have we kept it holy. We have been like the livestock salesman and the money changers from today's gospel reading, seeking to use the temple gathering as an opportunity to boost their fortunes and to bolster their own worldly standing. Oh, but Pastor, that's kind of a false equivalency, don't you think? After all, how have I turned the Lord's house into a house of trade? I've never chiseled a member of this congregation. I've never promoted myself in the narthex after worship. And I've certainly never used my standing as a Christian for worldly gain. But friends, I invite you to consider what else you might have promoted in this place. Have you ever, for instance, championed your personal politics when a neighbor needed you to point them to Christ? Have you ever wrestled with a scripture reading or perhaps a sermon because it did not fall in line with your worldview? Have you ever refused fellowship with a baptized brother or sister in Christ because their agenda was different from your agenda? If you've answered yes to any of these things, as I'm fairly certain we all have, then friends, it's time for a new agenda. It's time to clean house. And it's time to do so in the very same way that we read about in our gospel reading for today, in a very hands-on, no-holds-barred sort of way. It's time for the gloves to come off and to make plain to the world that that the sole rule and norm for our agenda in this Christian church is her Lord and Savior, who is its head. For if we are to call ourselves Christians, that is, little Christs, then it better be Christ and Christ alone whom we proclaim. Let no march, no movement, no rally, or any ridiculous, blasphemous golden idol come between you and the call that your Lord has issued. When you answer that call to come, to worship, and to be fed from the pure spiritual milk of the Holy Scriptures, do not mix this true food offered here with the false leaven of any other house. I tell you, dear friends, you'll probably be left with an upset stomach, or maybe worse. You may develop a taste for worldliness in place of the gospel, and I tell you that that kind of diet will not nourish you. What's more, these sad pretenses of piety that the world puts on in the name of being woke or traditional or progressive or conservative or whatever other label you want to attach to it, I tell you, your God sees through them all. When our text for today ends, we hear that Jesus was able to look into the very hearts of those who gathered around him to see the mighty work that he was doing. But Jesus did not, on his part, entrust himself to them, because he knew all people, and he needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man. I ask you, does that not rightly terrify you? Does a God who knows everything in you and about you not fill you with such awe that you just want to pluck out all that worldliness that separates you from him? But alas, we are all sinners, and we all cling to worldly things. We let our pride and our politics and our power get in the way of what it is that our Lord desires for us. We cannot, on our own, as it were, keep a clean house. But fear not, for our God does not invite us to clean ourselves up and then to come to him when we're presentable. No, he invites us to come and to be made clean. Clean on the outside through the waters of holy baptism into Christ, clean from within by the eating and drinking of his body and blood. Christ Jesus gives us these things that we may be called righteous before our God. And so these things are the reasons that this church on earth comes together. So let there be no other. Now then, in light of these things that we have in Christ, what about those things we talked about before? What are we to do with all those worldly labels? Are we to cast them off entirely and to live apart from the world in our ivory towers until it is that Christ returns again in glory? Well, no. All of this is only to say that our life of faith needs to influence our life in the world, and not the other way around. This is what I mean to all of you when I charge you to clean house. What is confessed here, what is taught here, and what is practiced here, I tell you, it's not just for here. It's for out there. The places that you go after you leave this place on Sunday morning. What that sign that you're seeing on your left as you exit the parking lot calls the mission field. Out there, you may have all different kinds of labels. You may very well be a salesman or a money changer, a brother, a husband, a wife, a daughter, a worker, a supervisor, a Democrat, or a Republican. Whatever labels you have, Christ gives you just one label, and it is the only one that truly matters. So go out from this congregation and be what he has called you to be. Be a Christian to your neighbor. Love them, serve them, and be as Christ to them in all that you say and do. And if you need to, yes, tie your own whip of cords, not literally, I hope, and clean house. Meaning, proclaim the law of God to your neighbors, living in open sin so that they might repent and receive forgiveness and reconciliation in Christ's name. For Christ himself did not come to Jerusalem only to drive sinners out of the temple, but he came to suffer and die on the cross so that they might be reconciled to God. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. This is what Jesus said about his death and resurrection, though they did not yet understand that this temple he spoke of, was his body, and the temple he cleansed was but a mere shadow and illustration of the work which was still to be done. Christ's mission was not merely to tear down, but to build up. In his proclamation of the law, he leads lost sinners to the cross, where they might see his goodness and mercy on full display. From Calvary, your Lord calls you to take your eyes off the world and its vain pursuits, to look instead on his beaten and bloody frame crucified there for you. Draw your hearts and minds ever and only to Christ crucified, and know that your sin has been atoned for, that he has made you his very own. Receive the free gift of life in his name, purchased and won for you by merit of his precious blood, spilt for tax collectors, for money changers, for prostitutes and sinners, the LGBT and BLM protesters, and the MAGA and Tea Partiers. Christ shed his blood for all of them, and he desires that they too would set their sights wholly on him. And so, this is our call, dear Christians. Be reconciled and preach Christ to one another, for it is his desire that all come to him and be made clean. Let his words be ever on your lips, that in all your thoughts, words, and deeds, in this house and in all houses, his good and gracious gifts may abound in this world and in the world to come. In Jesus' name, amen. May the peace of God, which far surpasses all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds in the same Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord, over all, we give thanks that the heavens declare your glory. We pray your blessing on all those who seek ways to use the resources of your good creation to feed the hungry, heal the sick, and shelter the homeless. Guide them toward bountiful harvests and life-saving technologies. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, who brought your people of Israel out of slavery in Egypt, hear the prayer of those who long for freedom from oppressive regimes, false imprisonment, poverty, and social discrimination. Awaken a desire for peace, justice, and human dignity in the citizens and leaders of our nations. Give them compassionate eyes so that they may seek to help one another, relieving hunger and despair with loving and sharing actions. Guide and protect armed forces deployed and those who work for peace and security in our local communities. Open our eyes to the vocation we have as people of faith each and every day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Wise and loving Father, who chose those whom the world considered foolish, weak, lowly, and despised to join in the body of Christ, give us your strength and wisdom. Open doors of opportunity for the church to preach Christ crucified and risen, no matter the form of opposition they encounter, so that many will come to faith. Strengthen clergy and lay leaders to focus not on institutions or statistics, but rather on righteousness, sanctification, and the redemption our Savior won in his gracious sacrifice for us in grace and in love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask your gracious answers to the prayers and petitions of those near and dear to us this day. Most especially do we pray for Jerry and Jean Albers, Jean Antilla, Pat Ballou, Linda Gantz, Ken Heidinger, Betty Jays, Riley Kirky, Andrew Rhoda, Nancy Seitz, Lane and Richard Vargas, Don Weaver, Joe Ziegler, Tom Zimmerman, Wendy Absher, Dave Beck, Wanda Bullhorst, Tim Crouch, Reverend Jeff Geisler, Ursula Hassan, and all those we name before you now in our hearts. Visit, relieve, console, and uplift them according to your good and gracious will, using us where possible as part of the answer to their petitions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you would have us ask of you, dear Heavenly Father, grant to us for the sake of the bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.